Okay, so this is a follow-up to my last teardown where I tore down my Xbox One. I'm going to be tearing down the Xbox, or the Kinect, and the power supply. I'm going to do the power supply last, as it looks like it's just a pretty standard switch mode power supply, so I don't expect there to be anything interesting in it. And if it fails, you're more likely to just replace it. The Kinect, I personally have seen one where the internal fuse blew, so it's a pretty easy fix. And it's probably a very common issue. So I'm gonna set the power supply. Whoops. You just knocked that off the table.
There went one power supply. All right, so.
All right, now with the general Kinect, you got this USB, it's basically a 3.0 cable, but the plug is a little bit different because it carries a lot more power. But the first thing you gotta do is get the two stickers on either side off. So I'm gonna pull out my handy spludger and get to work.
Question is that a technical name?
I believe it is.
Sure.
That one's just a generic sticker. The one over here, which has a white stripe on it, which that's out of frame. A white stripe right here, this is your warranty seal. As you start peeling it up, I can just see that it says Microsoft, but I don't think you guys can yet. So, as you peel it off, you start to see it basically just says Microsoft the whole lot through here. It said that if you try to return it at this point, they know you've been in it. And what you see, I'm gonna need to scrape some of this off, but we've got a bunch of Torx over here. And the one on the front and the one next to the stand, you can't quite see it, but I'm pointing at it, are just standard Torx. I wanna say a T15. I'll confirm that here in a second. But the two on the back, and this is mirrored identically over here, are security Torx, which those are the ones that have the little nub in the middle. If you don't have a stand or a security Torx set, you can usually break those little nubs out pretty easily. With a little pair of pliers or something. Or even just a flathead screwdriver sometimes. There we go. There's that. This one. Try not to peel too much of this backing off so that I can show you guys the positioning of the screws against the white background. Okay. Come on. I hate security bits. Alright, so now you can kind of see, you got a security here, you got a security here, you got a standard here, and a standard here. Alright. I meant to say this in the last video, but this is the iFixit 2015 Pro, this is the Pro Toolkit. That's too big. I got it a little while ago. I actually got this one from Mass Drop, but I got the 2016 screwdriver set from Amazon a little while ago. I personally like the 2016 screwdrivers better. I've not gotten the full kit, and it appears, yeah, it's a T10 security, not a T15. So now the entertaining process of me taking out a bunch of screws. And you also might notice through this video that the peanut gallery is not nearly as loud, and I'm hopefully much easier to hear this time.
Possibly. Also, it's because I'm not talking that much either.
Well, when he talks, is kind of what I meant. Oh, and also for the rebuild, in my left hand, on the right of your screen, that's a standard T10. In my left hand, or my right hand on the left side of your screen, the long screw is the security screw. Just in case when you finally get around to putting it back together, you get turned around backwards. And I will hopefully remember to point that out when I, well, no, actually I probably won't show a rebuild video.
Pretty much the long ones are on the front. That's back. The cutter, or
The long ones are in the back, the short ones are in the front.
Yeah. And hey, even if it's not broken, and you're like one of those people who like to clean out their systems, there actually is a processor and stuff inside the Kinect. So
the Kinect is basically a full computer this generation, unlike the Gen 1s on the 360. Now, while I do fully support the need to get into your own devices and clean them out, if somehow you still have your warranty, I would highly recommend you not getting into it, so that if you do break something, you can send it back to them. And what I just did, this is the bottom plate. I should have been showing you guys. What you do, once you get all the screws out, you want to lift up on the back side and then slide it. I just got stuck in. And then pull it towards the back. That will release the tab on the front, which is much less drastic than on the 360 itself. And there are also two little clips.
Xbox One.
What is it? 360? Oh crap, the Xbox One. There is a little clip here and a little clip here, which is I think what it got caught on. But if you don't lift it up, then it catches on this lip on both sides. So now that you've got this far, there's this fan shroud on the back, which also has your cable going into it. The first time you take the cable out, it is extremely stiff, and it's very hard to get back in.
Left the rubber grommet out on mine.
We had to after I think the second time we went into it, for whatever reason.
I mean, it wasn't that much needed, and honestly, it just made it hold it in there better, and mine hasn't fallen out in the past 6 months since we did this.
Yeah. So the fan shroud seems to be clear. It's just the cable holding it on. This part really sucks. What they did, they kind of got it going in an angle and then going straight in. And it makes it very hard to remove. Okay, so the entire fan shroud is moving. Ah, okay. So lift up on the back, just like on the bottom side. The side guards should not come with it.
They can, though.
I'm not going to say they can.
Well, I'm just saying they are moving right now. That's why I'm saying that.
Well, they're moving because they're now loose.
Yeah.
I'm actually going to remove those to see if I can get a little bit of free space. I don't want to just lift up on this to the point where it releases. I'm also getting kind of pissed off at it.
Actually, I don't remember if that actually came off.
You know, looking at this, I'm wondering. I think it did. Yeah, it does. Okay, I can see tabs. I don't think I can get the angle I want. Also, might help if I was on the plastic tab instead of the EMI shield. I know I'm out of frame, guys. It's kind of hard to show you. But I looked right in here, right at the joint. I don't think you can see it, and I don't think we can get an angle on it that we can show you. But it is maybe half an inch in. There's a plastic tab joining the top plate to the front plate. I just got that on the release. Oh, my screw goes all the way through.
Do you need to take the screw out?
Don't know. I might. What I just noticed, actually you can kind of see it here, going through this metal plate, this heatsink chunk, and the EMI shield up here, there is a notch that is obviously for a screwdriver. I don't remember the exact order, so I'm just gonna see what happens.
It may or may not go boom.
Well, it won't go boom right now, it's got no power. It may go boom when I put it back together, or when I plug it back in, which would really suck.
Man, what's not needed anymore? Hey, Cortana. But it is nice to be able to just yell at your Xbox or turn on.
Yeah. Oh, I made progress. Oh, right, ribbon cable to the stand. Right. No, the stand. Okay. So, what I just did, I had the stand up like this the entire time so that I could get at the screws on the back plate. Which unfortunately, when I started to release this front, it was actually locked onto this lip at the bottom here. When I put it flat, it just slid right off.
See, I didn't think that came off.
It can. It's the same thing I figured out with the putting it back together. If I take the top plate off, it actually goes back together easier.
Great.
Now, I did not need to take it apart. I don't think I needed to take it apart when I was working on your Xbox.
You did. Nah, because I put it back together too. Took it apart, put it back together. Funny story, I'm the one who found the fuse.
Yeah, he did. I thought it was a capacitor, I think. Alright. I really hate this stupid 3.0 port.
I think you just gotta pull it. There was nothing crazy about it.
You had it. When you got to it, you had already been taken apart once.
No, I was there when you took it apart the first time, too.
Yeah. Nah, I just got it stuck. There we go. Okay. Fine. So what you can see here, this looks just like a USB-B 3.0 port to me. Mine is much better mounted than I remember yours being.
Yours is newer than mine.
Not drastically.
It could be one generation difference.
But still, I had actually gotten that port out on yours.
Yeah.
So I'm just gonna set that out of the way. So I'm starting to lose my table space here. So now what you've got the fan hanging down. And you can kind of see where it goes into the EMI shield and then to the 4-pin plug here. And this looks like it is just a standard 4-wire. Yeah, I'm not going to do that.
Xbox One is doing the 4 wires.
It's a PC standard, and the Xbox One is a PC.
Well, fun.
So now what you've got 4 screws on this side, and you've got 5 over here around the... You've got your camera. This is, I believe, the IR emitters array, and this is your IR receiver, I think. And then this is just the Xbox light. Right here. And this is how it lines up. So you've got the camera. These are the IR LEDs you can frequently see through the front of it. And then this just lights up the Xbox logo. It's also how you know when you yell at your Xbox that Cortana actually heard you for startup. Use a torque wrench for this one. Freed the little light, which I did that because just to get it out of the way. And also now I can access the ribbon cable here, which threads down here behind the IR, or actually behind the hinge right below the IR array, down to the microphones. So I can go ahead and, it's not that style zip. Okay. It's not one of the, sorry?
I was gonna say liftable ones.
Yeah, it's not a zip where it's got the little locking tab thing. I want to use this one. And then this piece right here, it kind of looks like metal, but kind of feels like ceramic. It's called a ferrite core. And what it is basically just noise filtering. So once you get that free, which you've got, hold it out of the way, you've got a pair of screws on this side, and a pair of screws recessed here, which are holding on your bottom bar. Jesus. Something about this seems much more magnetic than usual. Say is it does look like they used a pretty standard screw throughout this. Is the black one, or all the black screws I've pulled so far, you've got the 4 long security torques, and all the other screws so far have been little short T10s. Come on. So you shouldn't have to worry too much about which screw goes where. Crap fell out of it. Trying to do this where you guys can kind of see what I'm doing. Okay. So now we have a microphone array separate. And I can't really see much of a way to get into this. If you should need to, it looks like there are a couple tabs on the bottom. Oh no, actually those are the microphones. I don't really see an ingress for this. And all it's gonna be is a bunch of microphones set up in an array. So I don't really see a need to go into that. Oops. I'm definitely trying not to do what I just did.
Miss.
Fall out. Miss too.
Yeah, I want to damage the board.
Yeah. I got very lucky with the Xbox One and missed the traces in the area that I smacked with my pliers. Which I think we cut out of the video.
Did we?
I didn't see it.
Maybe. Yeah, we had to do a little bit of cutting because of time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, unfortunately that video turned out to be almost an hour long. And that was much longer than I wanted it to be. Mostly because I had problems getting into it. And it may turn out that this video, we end up having to cut the power supply into its own short video, which I will feel really stupid about. I see the time. Yeah, Peanut Gallery was just pointing out that first video clip we're starting to get a little long on. That's the unfortunate thing about showing the full teardown, is sometimes it just takes time. Alright, so I've got the main board released. Before I start taking it off, you've got this black cable coming up here. That is to your camera. And what you guys unfortunately cannot see very well is that there is a piece of plastic running the full length of the board, and it's about an inch wide from the front, which covers that connector. So what you do, get something, and a flathead screwdriver works just as well as these spudgers I'm using. Almost as well. You just pop the plastic tape back so you can access this connector, and then get something underneath it and release that. I want to say that's all of it, but I don't remember, so I'm going to be very ginger when I'm doing this. I'm also trying not to stick my fingers all over the lens. What am I stuck? There we go. Something is still...
Okay.
Yeah. So, right between the camera and the IR receiver, right in here, which you can just see a gray line of, there is another connector. And it's the exact same thing. You get something in there to separate it off and releases. So now you can see where it connected to the board. So, there's also a connector right in the middle of the board. It is a hard board-to-board connector. Get the fan out of the way. You can see it goes into right here.
Looks kind of similar to almost like a SATA cable, or...
It does kind of look like a SATA cable. On this board, what you've got, this, I'm gonna say, is either RAM or flash memory. Underneath here is your processor.
That's a thermal pad, isn't it?
Yes. This is a thermal pad. It's basically the same as thermal paste. It's just thicker. I personally am not a huge fan of them, but in this situation, I'm not sure if I need the fill. But the processor, it's some proprietary thing. I have no idea if you put it back. I may replace yours with Noctua.
Yeah, but remember I took it apart again.
I know.
And that's where that fuse is.
Yeah. And then what I found wrong with Peanut Galleries, I don't remember exactly what fault he had, but it basically didn't work.
Didn't turn on.
Okay, yeah, it didn't turn on. This little thing here, which it's a little out of focus. Let me see if I can, yeah. This thing right here, this end is the fuse. You can bend it up. This is just a plug-in connector, which I'm not gonna try to take out. But if this fuse blows, the Kinect doesn't work. Okay, so I'd say this is probably the most likely point of failure. Most of the stuff on this board is pretty stable, and it all looks like it's either, if it blows, it's gonna be pretty obvious. You'll see a crater in the top of the chip, or it'll just be a black mark. Over here, you've got what looks like the power supply, or some sort of power conversion circuitry at least. You've got the two capacitors, you've got an inductor, a couple diodes. I'm not gonna name off everything. I don't know why they have this LED here. I don't think you can see from outside of the box.
Is that the top or the bottom?
This is the bottom of the front. So it goes like this. This LED is right here.
Yeah, you should be able to see it. Yeah, you can.
Oh, yeah, okay, I see that now. Okay, so this LED is the one that tells you that the camera is running. Or the, the Kinect is using its camera. And then primarily on the top side, you'll see these little metal, I don't really know what to call them, but they're made out of like spring steel or something. And their job is to connect the board to the frame for grounding. So,
ground box.
If you mar the crap out of them, don't do them all. But you should be okay if you only scrub one or two. So I'm gonna set that out of the way now. And what we're left with here is basically the sense unit. What you see end on is this heat sink is pretty thick and also runs the full length of Kinect. And they're using just about every spot they can to try and get as much heat sinking as they can. So they must have really gotten scared with the 360s overheatings. The only reason I can think to use that much heatsink for this unit.
And then they realized, oh wait, this is a lot of heatsink. Let's not worry about it when they did the Xbox One S.
I probably should have done the broken these free first. These screws here appear to primarily be holding the EMI shielding on the bottom side of the Kinect. But getting that first 16th of a turn takes a little bit of effort. And again, it's relatively distinct in the difference between the screws. This screw is noticeably larger, and it's the one that holds the PCB in. This screw in my left hand is the one that's holding the EMI shield on. So now, all the screws are out of the EMI shield, and this entire sense frame should lift straight out. Yep. So what we're left with is plastic with a metal backing, and that's your EMI shield and some frame. And then we've got this unit. So again, you got your primary camera, you've got your IR receiver, you've got your IR emitters, which I am not going to take off this time because too much effort and there's really nothing to see there. What I will do is these three boxes are metal. Well, two boxes, sorry. And they're basically shielding. So you pop this one off, you've got three capacitors here. This is an inductor. And I didn't use any tools for that, I just used my fingers. On this one, I'm going to because I don't have anything to grab onto, but it's just compression fit.
I'll squeeze it too hard and break it up. That's something I don't want to do.
Yeah. It is very thin, very low gauge metal. So if you grab it too hard and squeeze, you will squish it. This is definitely time for either a spludger or a flathead screwdriver. So now we lift this one off, and what we've got exposed here is an LMV339, which I think it's just an op amp. Number of pins says it's probably a quad op. There are some other very small SMD chips, but they're nothing major. So it looks like all this over here is probably mostly power regulation. On this one, you've got, I don't know what this little chip is off the top of my head, but most of the stuff around it is power regulation stuff. You've got capacitors, some inductors, might be a couple of resistors. And up around the IR camera, there are two very small chips that look like they're reading 75C. I'd have to look that up in a database and see what those are. So unless that's the Kinect, I don't really see anything else we can go over. If the fan craps out, replace it like for like. If the fuse craps out, see if you can find one. Hopefully it should be labeled on it what it is. Yeah, it's level right on it. You have to punch it into Google and see what an SETX9 is. It's probably gonna be like a 2-amp fuse. Or do what I did with peanut gallery's Kinect and just twist the wires together and put a little dab of solder on it.
And pray to whoever you believe in that it doesn't blow again.
Yeah. The problem with bypassing a fuse like that is if it does go bad again, if you take out the fuse, then you have no protection for the circuit.
Which means something further and less fixable.
Yes. Okay, so just finished the Kinect teardown. So now on to the power supply. As I've said in my prior two videos, I really don't expect there to be anything all that interesting in here. So, off we go.
Or not.
Or not. There we go. Oops.
Is it another trick?
No, it's not a trick this time.
Oh.
What he's referring to, if you guys didn't watch Microsoft One video, is normally underneath the feet of the Nautronic is where the screws are. In this case, I was starting to think it might be because I wasn't feeling the dip for the screw. But what I did instead, this is gonna be kind of hard to show you guys. I actually stabbed my tool through the foot, which is why it was fighting back so hard. So that is clearly in the side of the plastic. As he drops it.
Perfect landing.
It actually was a perfect landing right by my tools. So now I'm gonna wait for him to fix the focus. Okay. And down at the bottom, yeah, you guys can't see that very well, but it looks like it's another security T10. Let's see if we can do this one without
the puncture.
Yeah, never mind. Puncture worked.
You get you out of there. Why not?
Actually, this one is not working for me.
You got lucky.
So I got lucky something. Yeah, this foot is not going back in.
Why?
I'm shipping it out. Good thing I don't really care.
Right.
There we go. Okay. That's salvageable. That looks like crap, but it's about a power supply. Microsoft did not design this very well, in my opinion, for any sort of real repairs. And again, in case you guys have not seen my videos before, and hopefully before you guys start throwing all kinds of comments on it's a power supply, it's got high voltage, you shouldn't be doing this. This is pretty much what I do for work, except I do it for industrial devices, which are running on 12 times the voltage and hundreds, if not thousands of, well, actually I haven't worked on anything that big, but hundreds of amps, multi-ton presses, basically the things that run America, or, well, any country, not just America.
This also has not been plugged in almost a week and a half.
Yeah.
Just to make you feel a little more confident.
Shit. That's great.
But, just saying, there's probably, you told me about times when you just didn't feel your hand for a little bit, so.
That's true. What are you referring to? I was on a job site a couple months ago. Actually, two different stories. Which, actually, I'm not gonna. Yeah, screw it. Two different stories. One is I was working on a motor. I went to put my hand on the side of it to see if it was running hot because something didn't seem right. And when I put my hand on the side, it didn't add up. So I flipped my hand over, so I was using the back of my hand, and it felt like I was gonna burn myself. The other time was much more recently. I was working on a machine at a customer's, and I was trying to pull a cover off of an e-stop. I was trying to see if it was getting, or not an e-stop, it was an indicator lamp. I was trying to see if the indicator lamp was blown or if it wasn't getting power. And I had my hand on the frame of the machine. and it was 110 volt logic, and that is not the right. No, that was brilliant. Picked up the right size bit, put it on the pad, and put the same screw back in. So now that I'm in here, I know this is gonna be, I'm pretty sure this is gonna be a fan, but I'm kind of curious what style fan. And they flipped a Phillips inside. It looks like a pair of number twos and a pair of number ones. Yeah, number one's just a little bit small for this, so that's tells me it's number two. And I skip. So it's gonna be number two. But I felt a shock, and it was pretty much all the way across my body. As soon as I realized what the hell was going on, I promptly ruined my hand and was very grateful to still be standing upright. I'm pretty sure the reason I'm not severely injured from that is it was a logic device, so it was only a couple milliamps. And it takes much more than that across the human body to do serious damage. It
takes 1 amp.
An amp? Okay.
An amp, yep.
Yeah, most of the time, industrial logic is under 100 milliamps. So that's 1/10 of lethal levels.
Basically, 1 amp stops your heart.
Yeah. Again, I was extremely lucky.
Well, damn, that's definitely not as clean as your Xbox.
Yeah. Unfortunately, I can't get a great angle. Oh, wait, it's him. 1 second. The fan's on a header. This is more of what I expected from the Xbox in the last video. I'm trying to see if I can show you guys a great angle. So what you can see here, the gray crap here is all built up dust. You can also see it in the case on the sides of the input and apparently on the tip of my tool. And then this is a different style fan from the ones in the Xbox. Excuse me.
It's like an inversion, right?
I think this is an axial fan.
Axial.
Okay. What you got is you got a squirrel cage rotor in the center, which from the arrow here, the arrow is pointing this direction. So this is going to suck in air from, that should be both sides, but from the way it's mounted, it's gonna be this side. So it'll take air in this direction and blow it out that way. So it's sucking air past all the components in the power supply, because it was mounted roughly like this. So it's sucking in air here and blowing it towards me in current configuration. So I'm gonna have to clean that before I put it back together. Trying to see, oh cool. So once you take the case off, everything else is just sitting there. The entire body is held on by an EMI shield, which they soldered to the board.
Probably grounding to them.
It probably is acting as a ground frame, which is really funny, because as peanut gallery just threw in there, there is no ground on this pin, which this is the exact same shape and size as a normal computer, desktop computer power plug. I don't know if I have one laying around over there. And then when you go into the power supply, so you've got your 110 in here, through these two, I want to say they're inductors, but I think in this situation they're a choke. This is a polyester capacitor, most likely, yes. 0.68 microfarad. You've got two bus caps, so these are going to take your DC off of your rectifier here. And these two MOVs act as protection. I want to say that's either a 6 or an 8 amp rectification circuit. So your AC comes in, goes through this, which flips over to DC, charges up these bus caps to give you a little bit of tolerance for voltage spikes. These two here are MOSFETs or BJTs, which are basically switches in the electrical world. You've got step-down transformer in the middle here, and it looks like a secondary one. So this is gonna be your 12 volts, this is gonna be your 5 volts. I don't recognize these components as being just straight up like 5 volt regulators. They may be or they may be MOSFETs, and they're just using them as whatever. And then down here is mostly going to be filtering. I'm actually surprised by the number of pins going out. Because on this end, this is the Xbox end. You got one plug, which is positive. Okay, don't take which one I'm pointing at as the actual one. But you got the outside for the two circuits, and you got the inside for the two circuits. Actually, you might have three pins. So it may be that the center is acting as like a thermal switch or... No, okay, I think I know what's going on. So the outside is probably, let's say the common, it may be positive. The inside is probably the other version, and you've got the pin in the middle, which is probably gonna be like the green wire in a desktop power, which is a 5 volt SB or standby. That gives it enough power to do things like charge your controllers when the console is turned off.
Updates, probably.
That would be more hibernate. Which would still be pulling 12 volts, but it'll also give it the ability to actually turn on when you touch the capacitive button instead of needing a hard switch. And as I said, I mean, this looks like a pretty standard dual voltage switch mode power supply. I wish they hadn't soldered on the ground shield because I'd like to take a look at the back. Okay, this is kind of what I was expecting to see.
Is that split?
No, that's Sharpie. This little black box here, it's maybe 3/8 of an inch square and about an eighth or maybe a quarter inch thick. I want to say, look my way to you.
I mean, yeah, about.
This is a 6.3 amp fuse at 250 volts. So if you plug in your power supply and you do not get the orange light on with the Xbox unplugged, that's most likely what happened is this fuse blew. You can get those pretty cheap. You may not be able to get this exact fuse. It's a little PCB mount fuse, but any 6.3 amp, 250 volt fast blow fuse, I believe. Yeah, I don't know if it's fast or slow. I personally would prefer a fast one, and or start with a fast one and then drop down my speeds. Actually, no, it's a power supply. It might be a slow blow. That's Peanut Gallery's drink, not mine. And it is not alcoholic, it's soda. And unfortunately, he completely missed it. The logo is visible. I don't want to do product placements if I can avoid it, because none of these videos are sponsored.
Mm-hmm. I just read it and I was like, ha.
Yeah, they do have some interesting quotes on them. But yeah, this power supply, there's really nothing all that impressive. Oh, okay. So they did actually label the board.
There is something impressive.
It's not impressive, it's just...
It's impressive that...
It's sometimes... Sometimes they do it, sometimes they don't. So I'm looking here at the outfeed wires. You got double black and double yellow. Double black is your 12-volt ground. Double yellow is your positive 12 volts. They use double wires... double wires, because the 12 volt rail is, I want to say 17.9 amps, and then your 5 volt VSB is red, and actually I'm not sure which one they're using for common. Red is your 5 volt VSB, white is labeled as RSense, so that's going to be, it's going to be verifying that it is actually putting the right amount of power to this plug. And then blue is labeled as PS on. So that's power supply on. That's going to be the Xbox telling the power supply to go from hibernate, which is orange light, to on, which is white light. Hibernate is much lower power. Well, hibernate may not be the right term. But orange light is low power mode. It's not actually outputting the full power to the system. White light is full power to the system. The system then calls for the number of amps it needs. What I've read, this power supply is roughly twice what the Xbox is pulling. But I have not confirmed that myself, so don't take that as canon or stated law. I read it on a single Reddit post. Yeah, for the most part, this looks like it's just a standard switch mode power supply, which is pretty much what I expected. I just didn't expect that power supply fan to be quite so disgusting.
It runs more than the fan on the Xbox One.
That one will probably be running the entire time it's in white light. Whereas the Xbox One is only going to be running when it's on. So, as usual, guys, if you like the video, like it. If you want to see me do more, subscribe. And if you have any comments you want to say, put them in the comments. I will respond as quickly as possible. If you want to see me do any other teardowns or any other reviews of something, let me know, and I will definitely consider it. I won't guarantee I do it, but if I can, I will.
Give him an excuse to buy a PS4.
Peanut Gallery wants to buy a PS4. I really don't want to. So, see you guys in the next video.